Shall I start?
One second. Yes.
Jai Hind, friends. In our last 7 episodes of the series of Great Escape, we heard about the detailed planning done by Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, and we heard about the involvement of his nephews and nieces and niece-in-law in this initiative, and above all, the role of Sri Sharat Chandra Bose, Major Shottaranjan Bakshi, Mia Akbar Shah, and others to make this plan a successful one. And in our last episode, we started to listen about the aftermath faced by the Bose family. Today, we will request Sri Abhijit Roy to continue with our discussion and to tell us about the successive events which happened when Netaji reached Germany, the events that happened in India and mainly to the family of Subhash Chandra Bose.
Thank you, Anushua, and a very good evening to you and Audrija, and Jai Hind to both of you.
Jai Hind.
And my Jai Hind to the viewers. Now, till the last episode, we have come up to the point where people of Calcutta and other areas in Howrah and other areas, they could know about the formation of the Azad Hind Radio in Berlin. And the shortwave in about 97.2 was also given. The posters and leaflets were stuck on the lamppost and on the walls, pasted there. So people knew about this. And many of them, they started, I believe, listening to this particular Azad Hind Radio Berlin very secretly at their homes or in their associations or whatever, wherever they could find the time, because it was not a quote-unquote legal thing in the British Raj to hear these things or hear the Azad Hind Radio in public. So this was happening, and particularly the All India Youth League, where Jitendranath Bose and Aurobindo Bose was directly involved. They were involved directly. They also, I mean, the intelligence was also shadowing them 24 hours, as I've told you. Now, as this was happening, on 20th of April, 1941, Jitendranath Bose was arrested from his residence of 38/2 Elgin Road. He was the first one to be arrested under Defense of India Act. Now, what was the charge framed against him? The charges framed against him was keeping contacts with Japanese. And that was a crime. Lala Shankar Lal was also arrested, but somehow through that alibi, which was the brainchild of Subhash Chandra Bose, he escaped, and the council on behalf of the British police, they could not do anything. So, keeping contact with Japanese, and that he is active, he is an active supporter of the ideals and different activities of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, and had been propagating this, because he was a member of the All India Youth League, mind you. He was a member of the Forward Bloc. So there were many reasons of propagating it. This to the people of India, which is totally anti-British according to the Defense of India Act. So Vijendranath was arrested on 20th April 1941. Now, in the meantime, after Vijendranath was arrested, the Consul General of Japan in India, General Ohazaki, succeeded in contacting Sarat Chandra Bose. Now, Mr. Okazaki was the Consul General of Japan in India. And one evening, particularly one Bengali gentleman, he came to One Woodman Park and met Sarat Chandra Bose, where he conveyed the message to Sarat Chandra Bose that Mr. Okazaki is keen to meet him. Now, how to meet him? If Mr. Okazaki comes down straight to One Woodman Park, that is not very much desirable also, because there are 24 hours of vigilance around One Woodman Park on Sarat Chandra Bose, on Sushil Kumar Bose. And also, there were certain people employed at One Woodman Park who were not above suspicion, who were also believed to have a connivance with the British. That's a different thing. So what to do? Now, accordingly, Sarat Chandra Bose instructed his son, Sushil Kumar, to pick up Mr. Okazaki from a certain place in Kolkata, namely Prinsep Ghat, and bring him along with him, drive him along with him to a particular place, a specific place at the banks of River Hooghly. Now, this place was Rishra. We all know that Sarat Chandra Bose had a house in Rishra, where at times he used to spend his weekends with his family. And this place is in Hooghly district and right on the Grand Trunk Road. And that house, Bose's house, is still there, standing on the banks of River Hooghly. It's a beautiful house. I would request people who are watching this, you can once visit Rishra. It is right on the banks of River Hooghly, on the GT Road itself, near a famous sweetmeat shop, Phelu Modok. And near that is the Bose house. And that in that portion of GT Road, if you ask any shop that where is Sarat Chandra Bose's house, they will tell you. Of course, that house no longer belongs to Sarat Chandra Bose, because immediately after Sarat Chandra Bose left for heavenly abode, you know, he had taken the initiative to have a paper called Nation. And he had his own printing press also. And by doing so, he was, for 1945, he was out of the jail. After that, with his own, practice, he could not save that much of money. He had to take some loan also. So in order to repay that loan, his wife, Bibhavati Bose, she donated this house to somebody who had given a lump sum amount of loan to Sarat Chandra Bose. So, but that house is still known as Bose House, and people know that it's a house belonging to Sarat Chandra Bose, in Rishra, right on the GT Road. Anyway, that's a different thing. So, Sushil Kumar accordingly drove his car to Prinsep Ghat, and he was waiting for Mr. Okazaki. Now a big car, a huge car, reached on the scheduled time. Mr. Okazaki got down from the car, walked a few steps, got into the front seat of the Wanderer car. Shishibose was waiting there on the driver's seat, and the car drove towards Rishta. Now, at a specific place at Rishta, the conversation of Mr. Okazaki with Sarachandra Bose started in a low tone while strolling at the banks of the River Hooghly. This was the first meeting. Now, the news of Subhash Chandra Bose had reached Japan. Through the Japanese ambassador to Germany, and this news in turn had reached the Japanese consulate in Kolkata. The message actually sent to Calcutta was, of course, a coded message. And after decoding this message, Mr. Okazaki was given the responsibility to forward this message to Sarachandra Bose. So sitting in Calcutta, through the Japanese Consul General, Sarachandra Bose got the message of Subhash Chandra Bose, who had reached Germany, who had started his activity, like he had built an army called the Indian Legion. He had formed an association called the Free India Center. And also probably they heard that this Free India Center had a national anthem, Janaganamana, and they had a flag too. So these things, and what was his activity, how he was broadcasting his message to all the Asian countries over this Azad Hind Radio Berlin. Okay, so after Mr. Okazaki, the next Consul General, Mr. Ota, took the responsibility to contact Sarachandra Bose. Now, from time to time, and in order to relay the message of Subhash Chandra. Now, Mr. Ota went a step forward to visit the Rishta house, because previously they were only strolling at the banks of River Hooghly. They did not enter Sarat Bose's house. Now, Mr. Ota once, along with his wife, Madam Ota, they visited Sarachandra Bose's house. And this time, Sarachandra Bose was accompanied by his wife, Srimati Bibhavati Bose. Mrs. Ota came there attired in a sari, and she was entertained by Srimati Bibhavati Bose inside the Rishta house. And while Mr. Ota and Sarachandra Bose, they casually walked down the banks of Hooghly, talking in a very low tone, and obviously the common topic was Subhash Chandra Bose and his activities in Germany. Now here, one thing, one serious discussion there. I have already said about the contact of Subhash Chandra Bose with the Japanese Consul General and the Deputy Foreign Minister of Japan in 1940 in a house at Suino Street, which belonged to Snehangshu Acharya. That was the start of the Japanese connection with Netaji. And after that, you know that Netaji had sent Lala Shankar Lal to Japan to have some negotiations, and Shankar Lal did it very successfully. And when he came down, he came back to India. Netaji was at that time in prison. Okay, so his message was also relayed through the visitors who used to go there, and specifically with encoded language, of course. Okay, so now the thing is that when Subhash Chandra Bose reached Germany, he was being closely watched by the Japanese. Okay. And after a few times, there was a direct connection in between the German embassy, Japanese embassy in Berlin, and Subhash Chandra Bose, sitting in Germany. So this contact was somehow renewed. And who was behind this? None other than Rash Behari Bose. Okay, I'll come to that later. So a few years back, if you remember, the West Bengal government had declassified about 64 files, secret files, and all of them were IB files. Okay. Mainly pertaining to the intelligence branch of the British Empire, it was seen from these files that British intelligence could trace three such meetings of Subhash Chandra Bose with the Japanese consul. Now, also an old telegram, very old telegram, which was also found in the archives, in the Japanese archives, it was found, okay, where Mr. Okazaki is requesting the Japanese government to keep contact with Subhash Chandra Bose while he was in Germany. Now, these secret files reveal the fact that the communications of Subhash Chandra Bose through secret meetings with Mr. Kageyama and Mr. Owasi early in 1940s, if you may recall, which I have said, held at the residence of Mr. Snehanshu Acharya at Suino Street, started the Indo-Japanese connection, and which in future was strengthened further with the coordination of another revolutionary leader, Sri Rash Behari Bose, who was himself in Germany at that time, in Japan. That time, Rash Behari Bose had gone long back to Japan, and he was married to a Japanese lady, and he was the head of the Indian Independence League, which he formed in Japan. Later on, with his in 1942, with his initiation, the INA was formed, which was led by Captain Mohan Singh. You know it. So one important aspect should be mentioned here, that in the historic submarine journey from Kiev to Sumatra, it was undertaken by Subhash Chandra Bose and his companion Abid Hasan, and that both were transferred from the German U-boat to the Japanese U-boat at Madagascar, was not a last minute immediate decision. The preparations were done from way back from 1940 and from the time when Lala Shankar Lal visited Japan at the instruction of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. Now, as I said, that Subhash Chandra Bose was closely watched by the officials of Japanese embassy in Berlin. So after a few months, contacts were established by the between Subhash Chandra Bose and Japanese government. Now, through whom? Through one Mr. Yamamoto. Mr. Yamamoto was the Japanese military attaché in Berlin, and the Japanese ambassador in Germany, Mr. Oshima. So through Mr. Yamamoto and Mr. Oshima, the contacts were renewed in Germany between Subhash Chandra Bose and the government of Japan. So this submarine journey was not just one day's decision and Subhash Chandra Bose started and everything happened smoothly, not that. These were discussed at the higher level, higher diplomatic level, before a final decision could be taken that yes, Subhash Chandra Bose will be sent to Japan from Germany. And mind you, that time the war had broken. Okay. Now, after the Great Escape, one important thing started happening in Bengal. The political scenario of Bengal started changing too. The Muslim League, which was there in the Legislative Council, the Muslim League Ministry, it was there, which was led by Janab Nizamuddin in Bengal, was really under threat because Mr. Fazlul Haq, Janab Fazlul Haq, was disgusted with the attitude of these Muslim League people. So Janab Fazlul Haq, he approached Sarat Chandra Bose. Janab Fazlul Haq was of Krishak Praja Party. At that time, he was supporting the Muslim League people forming the in the West Bengal Legislative Assembly. And he was not at all happy with the Muslim League leaders. So he approached Sarat Chandra Bose. Sarat Babu, let us have a secular coalition government in Bengal. So Sarat Bose agreed. Okay. So Mr. Janab Fazlul Haq also made a proposal to Sarat Chandra Bose that when we will form this coalition government, you will have to take the responsibility of the Home Ministry. Sarat Bose agreed. Okay, if you wish so, I will take the responsibility of the Home Ministry. Now, as this news started spreading, the British government gauged it as a very, very dangerous move. Because Sarat Bose, being the Home Minister of Bengal, that would have jeopardized all their plans, all their movements. And they did not waste a single minute or single moment to arrest Sarat Chandra Bose on 14th of December 1941, before he could take the oath, before Sarat Chandra Bose could take the oath and become the Home Minister of Bengal Legislative Assembly. The police took, the intelligence took a very, a very rapid action, and they arrested Sarat Chandra Bose on the 14th of December 1941 under the Defense of India Rule. Now, what were the charges framed? Same, keeping close contact with the government of Japan, this time not with the Japanese only, with the government of Japan, direct connection, and his close association with the revolutionaries of Bengal. That old charge, you know, that old charge, the revolutionaries of Bengal. Because Sir Charles Decker, the famous or infamous, whatever you call, the police commissioner of Calcutta, has given a note regarding Sarat Chandra Bose, that Sarat Bose has dedicated his press and his prestige to the revolutionaries of Bengal. So this was the idea of the police intelligence and the police about Sarat Chandra Bose and his association with the revolutionaries. And this assumption was strengthened further when Sarat Chandra Bose long back ago went to Chattogram in Chattogram court, high court in court, Chattogram district court, and he stood for Ananta Shingo there as a defense counsel of Ananta Shingo. And there he challenged statesmen, a statesman like paper, which were at that time the mouthpiece of the British Empire. He challenged statesmen because statesmen had made a sarcastic comment regarding that particular Sharad Bose is going to Chittagong. So that is the history we know. Now, Sharad Chandra Bose, therefore he was considered the most dangerous man in view of the British Empire. So specifically by none other, by, as I said, by Charles Steggert. And therefore, the after the arrest, he was not kept in any jail. He was not kept in Bengal. He was sent to a remote hill station in Tamil Nadu called Kunur. And he was kept under house arrest in a house called the Fair Light. The Fair Light. It is a house, it is a big house, which is actually very near to the Sims Park. Sims Park, Kunur, is a very big park. And right in front of the Sims Park, there is a Pasteur laboratory. Pasteur laboratory who make injections, you know, vaccines and all that. They make Pasteur laboratory. And if you just walk on the left side a little bit, you will find on the right this bungalow called Fairlight. Well, I was fortunate enough when I went to Bangalore with my to visit my son and his family. So my son took me to Kunur. We went to Kunur, we saw that house, Fairlight, is still standing there. And I was really so emotional. I just couldn't hold back my emotions there. Knowing the fact that for 4 years, my grandfather was interned in this particular house. And he was so lonely there that this loneliness had broken his health to a larger extent. So this particularly, he was taken there in Fairlight. Now about his sending to Fairlight in Faraway Kunur, there were two reasons. One was, in Kunur, there was an army training camp. So Sharad Chandra Bose will be under very watchful eyes of the intelligence there, right? Who can always stay in the army camps and come around and keep a watch on Sharad Bose and this and that. One thing. And the then viceroy there, Lord Linlithgow, he wrote a secret letter to the Indian Secretary of State, Mr. Leopold Emery. Now, which reads as under. I'm reading out the letter. Lord Linlithgow written to Leopold Emery, who was the Indian Secretary of State in London. What is the letter says? It is obvious that it was well to have Sharad Bose away from here. In fact, one individual went so far as to suggest that it was almost the case that cabinet meetings were held in his quarters in the jail. Because wherever Sharad Bose go, he will do some of the other political activities. That was sure. So send him to Kunur. His contacts with the Japanese were an additional reason for exercising the greatest care in his case. Now, before the arrest of Sharad Bose, British police also arrested another member of the Bose family. And he was Aurobindo Bose, sometimes in July, August 1941. Aurobindo Bose was one of the eyewitnesses of the Great Escape. And he, along with Aurobindo Bose and Ila Bose, also kept this as a secret for about 10 days or so after Netaji left. And they were also associating Netaji in different aspects, you know. regarding the Great Escape. He was also a member of the All India Youth League, because under the instruction of Subhash Bose, Dijendranath has made him a member of the All India Youth League. Aurobindo, one fine morning, he dropped in at his uncle's place at Hazaribagh. His uncle, Sri Sudhir Chandra Bose, who was there in Bihar, he was in Tata Steel, a coal expert in Tata Steel. He had built a house at Hazaribagh. So one fine morning, he dropped in that Hazaribagh group. Everybody is asking, Sudhir Bose was also enjoying a holiday there, weekend, I believe. He said, "Well, Aurobindo, how come you are here?" "Well, no, I'm too tired, you know. I want to have a full rest. That's why I come. I'm very tired. I'm very sick too." So he, in order to have a well-reserved rest, following tremendous mental anxiety, he went there, his uncle's place. The British police actually arrested him from Hazaribagh and transferred him to Hijli jail. You know where Hijli jail is at the present moment, where the IIT Kharagpur campus is there. That was the place where we had the Hijli jail.
Another infamous destination for the revolutionaries.
Yeah. And it was such a remote place at that time, Kharagpur, and all those areas full with forests and all that. Once a man is brought there as a prisoner, it was impossible to get outside and keep contact with the outer world. Such dreadful place was that Hijli jail. Anyway, on 24th March, now, Reuters flashed the news that Subhash Chandra Bose had died in a plane crash at the Japanese coastal area. Now, very few people believed the news, as on that particular time period, Subhash Chandra Bose's speech were often heard being broadcasted from Europe, from Azad Hind Radio Berlin. So if he is there broadcasting from the Azad Hind Radio Berlin, how could he die in a plane crash in a Japanese coastal area? So his presence near Japan at that particular time or that particular time period was not possible at all. As usual, after Reuters flashed the news, many well-wishers, many family members, many relations, they started visiting 38/2 Elgin Road to express their condolences to Srimati Rubabati Bose, Netaji's mother. But to their utter surprise, they saw Srimati Prabhavati Bose being totally unperturbed. And calmly, she said to everybody that, "I don't believe in this false air crash. My son cannot be dead. He is alive. And he is going to complete his mission for which he has gone out." This was Prabhavati Bose. Often again, she could keep her composure, calm composure. She could scold back the British intelligence officers. Okay. And she was a woman of great patience and courage. And obviously, such mother will give birth to a son in the stature of Netaji. So this was now in the month of February 1992, there was another shocking news awaiting the Bose family. Dhirendranath Bose, the eldest son of Sri Satish Chandra Bose, suddenly died during the night time. Now, he had suffered from a cerebral hemorrhage. There is a brain hemorrhage at night time. When he was getting up from his bed to go to the toilet, all of a sudden he fell down on the ground and died instantly. That's what I've heard from my mother. Now, he had suffered. He had been suffering, I believe, from a long time, which could not be diagnosed. Now, Dijendranath was then a captive at the Alipur jail of Calcutta. After hearing this news, obviously he wished that he should go home to see his brother, elder brother, to do his last rites at the crematorium and to visit his parents and his grandmother. No. The answer was no. He was not allowed to go to his home. He was only allowed to go to the crematorium to perform the last rites of his elder brother. And from there onward, he would be taken back to the prison. So, the family members present at the crematorium and also the family friends present there saw the painful scene that Dijendranath, handcuffed, was brought in a police van to the Kalighat crematorium, which is called Shahnagar crematorium or Kauratala crematorium, and was only allowed to perform the last rites of his elder brother before the body was on the pyre. Okay. And from there onwards, he was straight away taken back to jail. And he was not allowed to meet his parents and his grandmother and other relatives back at home. Instantaneously later on, Dijendranath was transferred to Lahore Fort on April 1942, where he was physically tortured. Why? He just protested against the unhygienic conditions of the prison cell. Now, a Pathan warder kicked at his hip bone, just below the spinal cord. And the kick was so hard that he fell unconscious. And this injury was so vital that Dijendranath could not walk properly for the rest of his life. But this was an immense physical torture. People may believe or not, but it's a fact. The immense physical torture on one of the members of the Bose family. I'm leaving behind the mental tortures. This was a physical torture. Total. Like a third degree, which was used with other revolutionaries. Now, on 8th of August, 1942, the All India Congress Committee held at Mumbai, or Bombay at that time, took the resolution of Quit India Movement. And the all over India, this movement started where lakhs and crores of people, they participated with just one slogan, British Quit India. Now, after hearing the news of the Quit India resolution, Subhash Chandra Bose appealed to his countrymen through Azad Hind Radio Berlin in a brief speech broadcasted from there, asking the people of his country to join in mass in this Quit India movement. Accordingly, many rallies were taken all over India, all over Calcutta. And one such rally was taken out from Calcutta Medical College in support of the Quit India resolution. It was led by many leaders of the Students' Union, including Shishir Kumar Bose. And the police lathi charged the rallies there. Shishir Kumar suffered a head injury and was forced to stay home for 3 weeks. A few weeks after the incidents, a big police force raided the Sarathchandra Bose's residence at One Woodman Park. Now, before police could enter the house, a few important notes and letters had to be burnt out. In those days, what used to happen, letters were burnt, okay, and the ash was thrown into the common and flushed out, so that no trace even for the burnt papers. So this was done, and this was mainly done at the supervision of Srimati Vibhavati Bose. So that was done because particularly these things, I mean, these small things, you know, they actually make a very important thing. Police do not get any clue. Police don't get any specific thing which can prove about the involvement of that particular person in a anti-British propaganda or agent. So police could not seize any important and secret documents. When police could not find any objectionable document in the house, they arrested Shishir Kumar and took him to Presidency Jail of Kolkata, of Calcutta. Now, while in the Presidency Jail, Shishir Kumar was just convalescing. You know, he was a convalescent patient because he had a head injury. He was staying at home. Then he was taken to Presidency Jail. So there, he was down with typhoid, because the water of the jail must have been very unhygienic or something, and he was shifted to Medical College Hospital for treatment by the police. Now, while in his sick bed, Shishir Kumar received a message from his father, Sarathchandra Bose, who was under house arrest in faraway place Kunur, as you know, now Tamil Nadu. Now, while Sarathchandra Bose was under house arrest in a bungalow called Fairlight in Kunur, as I've already said, the British authorities had given permission at times for some of the family members to visit him. And through these visitors, Shishir Kumar got this news, got the message from his father about the, in time, in medical college while in the sick bed. The news which was sent by Sarath Bose was that British had already come to know about Shishir Kumar's role in the Great Escape. But to a large extent, they could know. Many things they could not find out. But actually, they could not frame a charge sheet, as there was, as they did not have any documented proof, number one. And they could not find out a witness who would say with certain documented evidences about the role of Shishir Kumar in the Great Escape. See, you see, that watertight secret mission was a bit successful, because the news actually leaked, as we are told, The news actually reached from Kabul. It leaked from Kabul. Because I believe Uttam Chand Malhotra, who's in his house, Netaji was staying for a few days in Kabul. His wife accidentally told one of the neighbors, wife of one of the neighbor, that Bose Babu had stayed in our house. So from there, the leakage came down and they were doing some back calculations. And as they were going around in those railway stations with the portrait of Subhash Chandra Bose, one of the ticket collectors, he somehow said, yes, this face looks very familiar, but the man whom I am seeing, he had beard and he was dressed like a Pathan. So they could make out with back calculations, but could not prove anything because they did not have any documented evidences and they could not find out even a single witness who would stand in the court and say something about the Bose brothers or against Sarat Chandra Bose or any of the member of the Bose family. Okay. So Shishir Kumar got this news and even Sarat Chandra Bose said that his illness was like a boon in disguise. Otherwise the British would have sent him either to the Red Fort or to Lahore jail, or anywhere in a very difficult place, out of the reach from Calcutta. So after recovering slightly from his illness, Shishir Kumar was released from prison and put under house arrest at One Woodman Park Residence. He was not even allowed to attend his classes at Calcutta Medical College. And after a while, Shishir Kumar was allowed to attend his medical classes, but was always closely shadowed by the British intelligence. Now, during the autumn vacations, that is Puja vacations of 1943, Shishir Kumar, along with his mother, Srimati Bibhavati Bose, and the younger siblings, went to stay at the residence of his elder brother, Dr. Ashoknath Bose at Barari. Now the reason of this visit was given to the police as that as Shishir Kumar had a attack of typhoid, he needed a change. And that is why he has been taken to his elder brother's house at Barari for a change, Now, in Barari one day, both the brothers and mother Bibhavati, they heard from Radio Singapore, Azadin Radio, Southeast Asia, in Singapore, they heard Netaji's voice while he was reading out the proclamation of the provisional government of Azad Hind in exile. So the news had reached like this to Bose family that Subhash Chandra Bose is now in Southeast Asia. Okay. Now in 1943, Subhash Chandra's mother, Srimati Prabhavati Bose, left for heavenly abode. Now it is said that Prabhavati died on the 29th of December, 1943. The day when Netaji arrived at Andaman Islands, and he stayed at the Ross Island overnight to sail in a ship or in a boat to Andaman Islands to raise the flag, Indian national flag, at the Gymkhana ground in Andaman. So Subhash there did not know anything about his mother's passing away. In 1943, when Prabhavati died also, another son, Sarachandra Bose, was far away in Kunur, in Tamil Nadu. And he was not allowed by the British Empire to come down to Calcutta to attend to his last rites of his mother and be there at her Shraddh ceremony. So both the brothers had to stay away from Calcutta, and they could not just take part into the last rituals of their mother. Now, during this period, a messenger came to One Woodman Park. As there was nobody there, with a message, he came with a message from Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. As nobody was there, it was Shishir Bose who had to attend to this stranger. Now this stranger, gentleman, he introduced himself as T.K. Rao, Major T.K. Rao. Now he was once in the British Indian Army. He was imprisoned after the famous Battle of Tobruk in East Africa, after the British Indian Army was defeated by Rommel's army, German army, and he was taken prison. And he was brought to Germany as a prisoner of war, and later joined the Indian Legion. Now sitting in Germany there, Netaji had made a secret service in the Indian Legion, headed by Mr. N.G. Ganapule. There were people like Mr. N.G. Swami and this Mr. T.K. Rao, who were members of the secret service of the INA. Now, before Netaji started his historic submarine journey, he had instructed Major N.G. Swami to choose some of the selected members of the secret mission and come down sometimes at Southeast Asia to meet him later on, as the news would reach that. So after the historic journey of Subhash Chandra Bose and Abid Hasan in the submarine from Kiev to Sumatra, and later after the arrival of Netaji in Southeast Asia and forming the provisional government of Azad Hind in exile, a small group from Germany, led by Major N.G. Swami, started a tedious journey in a blockade runner ship, with a view to reach somewhere in Asia. After the extensive and difficult journey, this group led by Major N.G. Swami, Mr. T.K. Rao, being a member of this group, reached the Middle East Asia and could meet Netaji successfully. Now, in Germany, Netaji had, as I said, a small group of people who had taken extensive training, not only in secret service, but also in sabotaging program. So particularly, Rao was a member of this team, and this group was recruited in the provisional government of Azad Hind with a training center in Penang in Malaya. And they acted as the members of the secret service unit of Azad Hind Force or the Indian National Army. The T.K. Rao told Shishir Kumar that a small group with T.K. Rao had reached the coastal area of Kathiawar near the far north of India's west coast. After reaching Kathiawar Peninsula, they had contacted Netaji over radio message. And the news, and the sad death news of Netaji's mother had also been conveyed to him. So, after a long time,
it was on which time?
It was also in 43.
No, on 29th of December, Prabhupada Bose was passed away.
After that, a few days.
Early 1944, in first or second January.
Early 44.
Okay.
Just a minute. Shishir Kumar, for the first time, he heard the name Netaji, because Rao was always referring Subhash Chandra Bose's name as Netaji, and knew about the famous slogan, Jai Hind. The two things Shishir Kumar knew from T.K. Rao. Now, T.K. Rao named three to four persons whose name were referred by Netaji about the whereabouts of the above referred to meet them and tell them and give the news of Netaji to them. But unfortunately, all these referred names were either behind the bars of the British jail or they were too sick, because in the jail they were tortured in such a way they felt sick and the British had released them. They were not in a position to meet somebody or speak something. Okay. So, Shishir Kumar thought for a moment and requested T.K. Rao to see him on the next day inside the Metro Cinema. Now, Metro Cinema is in Esplanade, you know, which is at the Esplanade of Calcutta, at the heart of Calcutta, and bade him goodbye, because it was very difficult for Shishir Kumar to go around with T.K. Rao because the intelligence were closely following him. Okay, after Rao left, Shishir Kumar thought what to do. And he got out of the house, casually strolled through the streets of Bhavanipur and reached the house of Major Shottar Ranjan Bakshi, who was in prison, British prison. Now his brother, Mr. Sudhir Ranjan Bakshi, was at the house. So Shishir Kumar met Sudhir Ranjan Bakshi and told him regarding T.K. Rao and said what to do. So both of them discussed for a while. Now Sudhir Ranjan Bakshi was one man who was earlier sent to Northwest Frontier Agency along with Shanti Ganguly by Sarat Chandra Bose. I think I've told this already in my episode. So he was very much involved, but passively, not actively. And he was an employee of the Calcutta Corporation when Netaji had employed him when he was the mayor and the chief executive officer. So Sudhir Ranjan Bakshi said that, okay, you tell him to meet me at the corporation office tomorrow. The day after tomorrow. You're meeting him tomorrow? Tell him the day after tomorrow you can meet. So accordingly, Shishir Kumar, next day in the evening, Shishir Kumar met T.K. Rao at the Metro Cinema and told him about a meeting about meeting Sri Sudhir Ranjan Bakshi on the next day at Calcutta Corporation. After the end of the news trailer of the, at the cinema, Shishir Kumar told Mr. Rao that you go on watching the movie, I'm leaving. So he left the cinema hall, and on that day, there was a social function at the medical college. So being the president of the students union, as students union has arranged this, so as the general secretary of the students union, Shishir Kumar straightaway went from metro to medical college and addressed the gathering there. So the audience there, which included hundreds of medical students, both boys and girls, they were witness to the address of Shishir Kumar in the gathering of a social function arranged by the Students' Union of Medical College. So this was, everything went in order, and the meeting with T.K. Rao remained in oblivion. You know, nobody could know about that. So later on, we hear that this T.K. Rao took a false name as Prasad and met Sri Sudhir Ranjan Bakshi at the Calcutta Corporation. Maybe he had forwarded some news of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose to Sudhir Ranjan Bakshi to be relayed to other persons. Now, the intelligent personnel of British police had been closely watching Shishir Kumar. Okay, his meeting with Sri Sudhir Ranjan Bakshi, his going to the house of Shataranjan Bakshi, did not please the British police. So sometimes in the middle of 1944, Sudhir Ranjan Bakshi was arrested by the British police. During October 1944, Shishir Kumar was arrested by the British police for the second time on his way to the medical college. Now, Shishir Kumar was first taken to the intelligence bureau at Lord Sinha Road. Later, he was brought to his residence at One Woodburn Park and made to sit in a room at the first floor. And the entire house was searched thoroughly by the police. Needless to say that at the instruction of Vibhavati Bose, many secret papers could be burnt and flushed out through the commode in the toilets in time. Shishir Kumar was taken first straight away to Red Fort, Delhi. There are underground cells at the Red Fort, which people can see also today if we visit the Red Fort. Now, after being a prisoner there for nearly 4 months, he was transported to Lahore Fort. Okay, Shishir Kumar's cousin Dijendranath Bose was also imprisoned at the Lahore Fort. But both brothers did not know this. Okay, because he was in one corner, maybe another corner, where he had suffered a severe injury, Dijendranath, as I told you earlier. Okay. And the police did not disclose their whereabouts. All the three, Dijendranath, Aurobindo, Shishir Kumar. For a pretty long time, their whereabouts, where they are staying, how they are, it was not disclosed to the family. The letters written by the family members reached the police. They used to show them the letters. Look, your mother has written this letter. Your uncle has written this letter. If you don't tell us anything, we will not let you read the letters, nor we will allow you to write back the reply. This was a way of mental torture the three brothers were subjected to, the three cousins. Now you can well imagine there was no response from the police administration, even after repeated requests from the families to know about the whereabouts and welfare. How painful, can you just imagine how painful it would have been to the elders of the family to bear the pains of not knowing about the welfares of their sons or nephews? It's very well imagined. People who today, they deny about the participation of the members of the Bose family in the Great Escape, they have not felt the pains of the elders, that their sons, when they are imprisoned, where they are, how they are, is not being known to the family members. I sometimes feel that the members of the Bose family was fortunate that Srimati Prabhavati Bose was no longer in this world. Or else it would have been really painful to know about this particular state of affairs happening with their grandchildren, grandsons. Even Ila Bose, when she went to Jamshedpur to visit his uncle's place, Sudhiranjan Bose's place, there the intelligence officer came and started cross-examining Ila Bose. Why are you here? What purpose has brought you here? Ila Bose said, I've come to visit my uncle. I'm not well, I'm physically a bit indisposed, and I've come for a change. What is so harm? So this was the state of affairs. They were so frightened, police. So particularly, I think, about all these things, that the countrymen will realize one day, the way Subhash Chandra Bose started the uncertain and the dangerous journey for the liberation of our motherland from the British imperialists. It was an unique and unparalleled history, seldom found in the history textbooks.
Absolutely.
This unique struggle started on the 16th of January 1941. And after about an year of hectic preparation, the 8 members of the family were involved in this great episode of the Great Escape, at least the primary stage of the Great Escape. And the way they maintained the secrecy of this adventurous journey is worth mentioning here. This secrecy was maintained by all the 8 members of the Bose family, even after being subjected to various physical and mental tortures by the British administration.
Actually, most importantly, that saved Ila Bose also from the British torture.
Exactly. Because and those days, if you are not directly involved with revolutionary movement, it was very risky for the administration also to arrest a female.
Absolutely.
Because there would have been revolt. And only those, people who had been involved directly, Kalpana Dutta and Bina Dash and all that, they were directly involved. Prithilata Wadidar, Matangini Hazra, they were directly involved in the struggle. So there British could take an action because they had the proof, but not with others. Not with others. So Ila Bose could not be arrested because they could not found any witness. That's the thing. Well, as far as I had to say, about this particular episode. I've almost finished, but I just like to make a humble submission. And my heartfelt tribute to the great liberator of India, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, and remind all my viewers that the great escape which started on the 16th of January 1941 from 38/2 Elgin Road turned into a great revolution after 3 years. This revolution was in Southeast Asia, started from Southeast Asia, Singapore, with the formation of the Provisional Government of Azad Indian Exile and reconstruction of the Indian National Army or the Azad Hind Fauj, and then proceeding to Rangoon and the Burma border, entering further and capturing a major portion of the Indian soil on the 14th of April, 1944, at the northeast sector of our motherland. Had this armed revolution would not have happened, there was no chance of India attaining her freedom on the 15th of August, 1947. Here I conclude with one word. If any renowned historian or researcher wishes to contradict me or disagree to my above statements, it is a challenge. It is a challenge to those renowned people from this common ordinary citizen of India. Let them challenge me. I will say with proof that had not the INA captured Moirang on the 14th of April 1944, which followed by the surrender of one regiment of INA and the Red Fort trial, which created a hue and cry in the entire country, followed by the naval mutiny, the police mutiny, and the Air Force boycott lunch period, India would not have been free. So it was a fact, it is a fact, that the last nail in the coffin of the British Empire was hit, or was put by Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose and the army of which he was the commander-in-chief, the Azad Hind Fauj. Thank you very much to all the viewers and to all the members of the Desh for having given me such a patient hearing. But whatever I told you is history. And let this historic facts be written by some historians. Let this true history of Indian independence movement be documented in the textbooks of history. That is our only demand. And let us increase the awareness amongst the common people to increase the number in the demand so that our demand turns into a mass movement. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Jai Hind. And this is, I mean, we are fortunate to hear this detail of the great escape.
Now, next thing, I will have to do some. I've got some books by Mia Akbar Shah and also Bhagat Ram Talwar, although it's not much in detail, but Mia Akbar Shah was also jailed. He was in Peshawar jail for a long, long period of time because he was the president of the Forward Bloc, of the Northeast Frontier Province. So he was an important leader there also. And he had given responsibility to Bhagat Ram Talwar to guide Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose to Kabul. From there, he once again made a separate journey by renaming himself, getting another disguise in an Italian name like Orlando Mazzotta, and with a passport, Italian passport with a Russian transit visa, he left Kabul for Moscow. That's another story, another part of it. Maybe Mia Akbar Shah can, I don't know, he's not alive now. The other people, Forward Bloc and Northeast people, they could make a substantial contribution to this, but that particular part of the journey. Okay. So this much elaborate thing I've done. How many episodes has it taken? 8 or 10 episodes?
8 episodes. This is the 8th one.
8th one. Okay. So this is the last. So thank you very much. That's why where I end. And anything, I would like my viewers, if you have any questions regarding this, you can please send it through Desh. I will try my best to answer your queries, answer your questions. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Meshumasha, it is our heartfelt thanks to you that you gave so much of time to us and told us about the detail of Great Escape. And
it is my duty. I nowadays think this is my duty to let the people know about the historical facts.
Absolutely.
Sadly enough, the history taught to 3 generations is an untrue, distorted history. I don't know when the true history of India's independence movement, right from 1857 to 1947, will be written by a bold historian and documented in the textbooks. But what I think, it should come today or tomorrow. It will come today or tomorrow. For that, we need a mass revolution, a mass movement. Common people should come out in the streets and demand for the documentation of the true history of Indian independence movement.
Absolutely.
I'm just a common man. I'm trying to create this awareness and let an organization like Desh further carry forward this awareness to the common people. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And Jai Hind.
With this oath and with this hope, we are concluding our discussion on the Great Escape. But surely our Netaji Memorial series, which we have started on 24th of January, we will continue with that memorial series. And probably on 17th or 18th of February this month, we will know about the detail of Azad Hind Fauj, because 17th February is the raising day of Azad Hind Fauj. So yeah, we should remember those warriors and we should know the history, how Azad Hind Fauj was born and how it started to contribute in the history of the liberation of India.
Well, I'm told that Doordarshan is making a program. Doordarshan is making a program. They are trying to find out some speakers. But this 17th of February was the day when, under the guidance of Rajbihari Bose and under the leadership of Mohan Singh, the INA was formed in 1942. So somebody was asking me whether I could suggest a name so that Doordarshan may call them for the panel discussion. But frankly speaking, no proper word came to my mind. Because I don't know if somebody is there, still alive, who knows about a little bit of details about this particular INA, which was formed with the initiation of the Indian Independence League in Japan and under the leadership of Captain Mohan Singh.
We have actually requested Shubham to
Shubham will
interact
be,
with us.
Shubham knows better. Shubham, I think he knows more regarding the INA led by Netaji. but he can have some knowledge. He can have some knowledge regarding the previous INA also.
Yes.
Because Netaji actually, under the provisional government of Azadid, he reconstructed the INA.
Absolutely.
Reconstructed the INA. If I am to give the correct notation, INA was already formed, and he only reconstructed the INA under the provisional government of Azadid. Okay. Thank you very much.
So with this hope and this oath, we are concluding our session with Sri Abhijit Roy, with our heartfelt thanks to him. Jai Hind.
Jai Hind.
Jai Hind.